afternoon. Let's try that again. We're at Howard. Good afternoon. Very good. I'm thrilled to see all of you here today for the James Nabrit Lecture Series. As you know, the James Nabrit Lecture Series is a very special event every year here at Howard University School of Law. It gives us a chance to celebrate the life and memory of James Nabrit. And I'll say a few words about Nabrit now. James Nabrit was a graduate of Morehouse College and Northwestern University School of Law. He joined the Howard University Law Faculty in 1936, and 2 years later, he taught the first formal civil rights law course ever at an American law school. In the 1940s and early 1950s, Mr. Nabrit handled a number of civil rights cases for the NAACP Legal Defense and Education Fund, working with Charles Hamilton Houston, Thurgood Marshall, and others. He was one of the lead counsel on the Washington, D.C. case of Bowling versus Sharp, a companion case to Brown versus Board of Education, but which was decided under the Due Process Clause of the Fifth Amendment instead of the Equal Protection Clause of the 14th Amendment. Mr. Nabrit was the dean of this law school from 1958 to 1960, and he was later Howard University's second African-American president, first from 1960 to 1965, and then again from 1968 to 1969. In 1966, he represented the United States as a deputy ambassador to the United Nations, and Mr. Nabrit was considered one of the leading constitutional and civil rights lawyers of his generation. So as you can see, he is a person who is very important in the history of this law school, very important in the history of civil rights law, and so it is our privilege to honor him every year here at the Nabrit Lecture Series. Before I introduce Paul Sweeney of K&L Gates to bring us some special greetings, I would like to introduce one very special guest that we have with us today, and that is Mrs. Marshall, Thurgood Marshall's wife, and who is here with us today, and we are honored. And she joins us almost every year here for the Nabrit Lecture, and so we're honored to have you with us again today. The Nabrit Lecture would not be possible without the support of K&L Gates. K&L Gates has been our partner in the Nabrit Lecture Series for its entire existence, and we are thrilled with their support. This is part of their effort to really support the issues of diversity and inclusion, and so we welcome Paul Sweeney, partner from K&L Gates, to give a welcome.
Well, good afternoon and welcome. Let me begin by thanking Dean Holly Walker for arranging this 12th annual James M. Nabrit Lecture Series. As you know, Dean Holly Walker has been able to secure two outstanding speakers today. First will be Judge Robert L. Wilkins of the United States Court of Appeals for the D.C. Circuit. And later on this afternoon, we will have Donna Brazile, who is a Democratic political strategist and an adjunct professor at Georgetown University. So I'm sure you will enjoy their comments. Over a decade ago, K&L Gates decided to partner with Howard University Law School to commemorate the legacy of James M. Nabrit, who Dean Holly Walker has just described to you before. The first lecture, which I actually attended, commemorated the 50th anniversary of the Brown versus Board of Education decision. And as you know, Mr. Nabrit was one of the architects of that decision before the Supreme Court. Since then, in the past 12 years, we've had any number of speakers. We've had Supreme Court justices, U.S. Court of Appeals judges, Supreme Court judges, cabinet secretaries, special counsel to the president, congressmen, civil rights icons, and distinguished law professors. All very, very outstanding speakers. And it's every year, it's been just a tremendous experience, I think, for the students, the faculty, and for us from K&L Gates. And every year until 2013, we had present here James M. Nabrit III, who is the son of the individual for whom this lecture series is named. And Jim was a terrific guy. He was an outstanding attorney in and of himself. He argued a dozen cases before the Supreme Court. But he would come here with his wife, Jackie, and he'd sit down front with Mrs. Thurgood Marshall, and they enjoyed this series. He was a big, big supporter of Howard Law School. And so we appreciated everything that he did for the law school, as well as for this lecture series. And we miss him, but we know that he is watching us as we carry on with this lecture series. So it's with great pride and on behalf of K&L Gates that we welcome you to this lecture series today. Those of us at our firm who have a Howard connection are particularly proud. We have many Howard Law School and or Howard undergraduate attorneys at our law firm. And there are people like me who have a parent who graduated from Howard University Law School. So our connections run very, very deep, and we are very proud of our relationship. So we hope that this lecture will help to enrich your law school experience. We hope that you will listen, learn, and enjoy yourself as you listen to all of the lectures and the events that take place today. Thank you very much. And I guess next, okay, thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Sweeney. Now we have to introduce Judge Wilkins, Claudie Benz, who is the president of our Student Bar Association and graduating 3L. He only has a few weeks left with us, so we hope that this will be one of the highlights of your 3 years. Good. So welcome, Mr. Benz.
Colleagues, it is with pleasure that I introduce our guest speaker for today, Honorable Robert L. Wilkins. Judge Wilkins was appointed to the United States Courts of Appeal for the District of Columbia on January 15, 2014. A native of Muncie, Indiana, he obtained his BS in Chemical Engineering from Rose-Hulman Institute of Technology in 1986 and a JD from Harvard Law School in 1989. Following law school, Judge Wilkins served as a law clerk to the Honorable Earl B. Gilliam of the United States District Court for the Southern District of California. In 1990, he joined the Public Defender Service for the District of Columbia, where he served first as a staff attorney in the Trial and Appellate Divisions, and later for several years as Special Litigation Chief. In 2002, he joined the law firm of Venable LLP as partner, handling white-collar defense, intellectual property, and complex civil litigation matters. During his tenure with the Public Defender Service and during private practice, Judge Wilkins served as a lead plaintiff in Wilkins et al. V. State of Maryland, a landmark civil rights lawsuit that inspired nationwide legislative and executive reform of police stop and search practices and collection of data regarding those practices. Judge Wilkins also played a key role in the establishment of the Smithsonian National Museum of African American History and Culture, serving as the chairman of the Site and Building Committee of the Presidential Commission, whose work led to congressional authorization of the museum and the selection of its location. As a practicing lawyer, he was named one of the 40 under 40 most successful young litigators in America by the National Law Journal in 2002, and one of the 90 greatest Washington lawyers of the last 30 years by the Legal Times. On December 27, 2010, Judge Wilkins was appointed to the United States District Court for the District of Columbia, where he served until his appointment to the D.C. Circuit. Ladies and gentlemen, without further ado, please welcome our guest, Honorable Robert L. Wilkins.
Thank you very much for that very kind introduction. Thank you, Dean Holly Walker, for the invitation. It's quite an honor to be here this afternoon to speak at the Nabrit Lecture. There have been so many wonderful speakers. This has a proud legacy, and I will try to live up to that legacy as best as I can this afternoon. Thanks also to K&L Gates for their support of this very important series. History is very important to me, legacy is very important to me, and that's what I'm going to talk to you about today in my remarks about what I call the Forgotten Museum. You have heard that I was involved with the efforts to try to bring a national museum dedicated to African American history and culture to the nation's capital as part of the Smithsonian. And you are probably aware that that museum is under construction and that it is going to open in a few short months on September the 24th. I'm going to take you back through the 100-year journey of how that museum came to be, and along the way talk to you about the participation of graduates of this very law school in that journey, because they were there from the very beginning of the movement. Now, the history of Washington, D.C., of course, would not necessarily lend one to think that in this year we would have an African-American president and we would be opening a National Museum of African-American History and Culture. The history of Washington, D.C., like the history of the United States, is also a history that involved slavery of African Americans right here in the Capitol, with slaves being bought and sold right on in the environs of the National Mall. Here's an illustration from a book by Howard K. Smith depicting that. Harper's Weekly was kind of the Time magazine, or the Newsweek magazine. You young people don't even really know what Time magazine is anymore, because but it was a weekly, and it was the most kind of popular newspaper of its time. And that's an illustration from it showing slaves being marched past the Capitol building in 1836. This is from an account of someone who was visiting the United States and was so taken aback by the fact that just in the same vicinity of seeing the Capitol in this symbol of democracy and freedom and all of the lofty ideals of the Declaration of Independence and the Constitution, that this visitor also saw slaves in chains kind of within the shadow of the Capitol, and how could that be? Some of you have heard, have read the book 12 Years a Slave, or saw the movie. It's an actual autobiography, or also called a slave narrative, by Solomon Northrup. And he wrote about how he was kidnapped and sold into slavery, and part of his journey was in Washington, D.C. And this is an illustration from his book, where he's describing and talking about being in a slave pen right in the environs of the National Mall. So that's some of the history of Washington, D.C. and the environs of the National Mall. But of course, we fought a war, a civil war, to in part end slavery, and the Union was successful in that led to the 13th Amendment and the 14th and 15th Amendments, the Reconstruction Amendments, that were supposed to give blacks the right to vote, to all of the rights of citizenship, to equal protection under the law, and to right those wrongs of the founding of the nation and of slavery. At the end of the Civil War, President Johnson, who had inherited the office after the assassination of President Lincoln, thought it fitting to have a victory parade in the nation's capital for the Union troops. And if you think about it, back then, before internet and television and radio, et cetera, a parade like this is something that would be seen as kind of like the pinnacle of entertainment, a highlight. And so they planned this grand parade that they actually called the Grand Review, for May of 1865 to display the Union troops and let them bask in the glory. And it went on for two full days with about 80,000 soldiers each day marching from the Capitol down Pennsylvania Avenue past a reviewing stand near the White House. And it was a spectacle. Hundreds of thousands of people came to Washington from all over the country. There were people, you know, lining the streets. There were people on rooftops, looking out windows, wherever they could to see this procession. These are some pictures that were taken of the Grand Review by the famed Civil War photographer Matthew Brady. And you see soldiers all lined up going down Pennsylvania Avenue and the crowds there to cheer them and to salute them. What you don't see in any of those photographs, because they weren't there, were any African American soldiers, despite the fact that over 180,000 African Americans fought in the Civil War as part of the United States Colored Troop Regiments. Not a single regiment was invited to participate in the victory parade. The official explanation was that there were none available because all of the black regiments were going to be sent to Texas and various places where there were still some hostilities and where they were needed. And so none were available to march. I am skeptical of that explanation, and I actually did some investigation. I guess perhaps it's the public defender ancestry that I have, and actually looked at the records of all of the various Union troops and where they were stationed and what they were doing on the 2 days of the Grand Review. And there was actually a colored troop regiment right in Arlington, Virginia, sitting there as this parade was going on. You wonder what they were thinking as this victory parade was happening right across the river and they weren't invited. So there was some African American representation at the parade. General Sherman, who marched on the second day, did not believe in arming blacks and having them as combat soldiers, but he did employ blacks with his army, and they were part of what he called the Bummer's Brigade. They were people who would forage for supplies because he was down in the deep south behind the supply lines, and they would have to find food the best that they could. They were in hostile territory. They needed spies, they needed local intelligence, they needed to be able to build roads and bridges. And so he had blacks that, you know, armed with pickaxes and shovels, did those types of things, or tended to the livestock and the food and everything that they needed to basically serve in this auxiliary role. And so he let some of them participate in the march. And as this writer says, Edmund Hatcher, as the crowd saw these blacks who were, you know, carrying pickaxes rather than rifles and things, it was they laughed. They were seen as this comical appendage. A further depiction is that people were amused because there were, you know, black soldiers, not really combat soldiers, riding on very small mules, and that was a very comical display. And here he talks about the darkies who were part of the march, because Sherman, marching through the South, sometimes runaway and escaped slaves would follow along behind the army for safety, to try to get away from their situation. And they would do things like help and cook and serve, again, in these auxiliary capacities. And so some of these slave families marched along with Sherman's army. and people laughed at the darkies and the pickaninnies who were part of the Grand Review as part of Sherman's army. So there was an African-American presence, but it was there as the helpers, as the auxiliary people, as the comic relief. As you can imagine, that representation did not sit well with the African-American community. And so they decided to hold their own Grand Review. And a few months later, they gathered in Harrisburg, Pennsylvania. And this is a historical marker from Harrisburg discussing the U.S. Colored Troops Grand Review that was held there. And they had regiments from various states that participated. They had speeches, they had proclamations, they wanted full citizenship, they wanted voting rights, they wanted their proper respect as black soldiers and as citizens and as people who had fought to preserve the Union. Now I'm going to fast forward here 50 years, and in 1915, the 50th anniversary of the end of the Civil War, there was basically a reenactment or a commemorative march of the original Grand Review. Right after the Civil War, a Union veterans group was formed called the Grand Army of the Republic, the GAR. And they wanted to basically, it was a fraternal organization for Union veterans. They had a women's auxiliary group so that there was a women's relief corps of the Grand Army of the Republic. And they would hold events around the country. They called them encampments. They were like conventions, and they would have parades. They would also basically help to create what is essentially now Memorial Day of decorating graves and remembering veterans. And so this group was in charge of staging a 50th anniversary reenactment of the Grand Review. This time, African Americans could participate, though. The Grand Army of the Republic was a segregated organization, but at least there were black posts, and the black veterans could come and march. So many of them planned to attend. They couldn't march in the original Grand Review, but they would be able to march in this reenactment 50 years later. As the Grand Army of the Republic and everything pretty much in the United States was segregated at that time, there were African Americans who asked to be part of the, basically the Citizens Committee and this committee to organize the balls and the receptions and the tours and the various things. And they were told, no, you can't be a part of the committee. Form your own committee. And so that's what they did. They created a committee, they called it the Colored Citizens Committee, so that they could entertain the visiting soldiers, veterans. And of course, at this time, these visiting soldiers couldn't like go check themselves into a hotel. The hotels were all segregated. So they actually went to the trouble of organizing things so that people could open up their homes. They organized rides so that people would be able to get around. They organized their own tours. They created, had their own balls. They had to do everything themselves to organize and entertain these troops outside of the establishment organization. And they were very successful with what they did. These are some images from that 50th anniversary march. This is the Capitol as it looked in 1915 as they were preparing to stage it for the march. And this is almost the same scene as one of the Matthew Brady pictures from the Library of Congress archives. A lot fewer people then. The men, of course, are 50 years older, so some of them are walking over stooped. The news accounts say that some men, it's a 2-mile walk from the Capitol to the White House, and some of these men are in their 70s or even pushing 80 at this time. And some of them literally collapsed along the way, and some of them collapsed as they got to the reviewing stand because they wanted to make it so that they could be saluted by President Wilson. It was Woodrow Wilson was the president. So it was quite a scene. And of course, there were many who were too disabled to make it. They had perhaps lost a limb during battle or in the course of the 50 years since, and they brought up the rear in vehicles if they couldn't walk at all. And so this is the reviewing stand where the president and the Supreme Court justices and cabinet secretaries, et cetera, greeted the marching veterans. So the African American soldiers did, to some degree, finally get their due. It was 50 years late, and of course everything was segregated and they weren't kind of allowed to participate fully, but at least they got some representation in the march. Well, the Colored Citizens Committee thought that that really wasn't enough. And so some members of that committee decided to form an organization called the National Memorial Association to erect a monument to the Negro soldiers and sailors who had fought in the Civil War, but in all of the wars from the Revolutionary War up through the Civil War. And so this is from a newspaper article from the Washington Post, that they proposed a shaft or some sort of a post or memorial to colored soldiers. And they began a movement to build this. This is a flyer from promoting a meeting in 1916 at the 19th Street Baptist Church, which is still there. It's on 16th Street now, but it is a historic church where a lot of civil rights activity happened. And they had a push to create this memorial to Negro soldiers and sailors. I'm trying to be good and stand here because I'm being videotaped. The trial lawyer in me wants to pace and walk around and everything, but I told the dean I would be good and I would stand here, so that's what I'm gonna do. But they were able to have a United States senator and a congressperson there speak. Among their many speakers, and I wanted to, this is hard for you to see here, but this is a letter that this group wrote to President Woodrow Wilson in July of 1916, where they were basically telling him what they were doing and asking for his support and for a meeting. And he declined to meet with them. But what I wanted to point out to you is the fact that Howard Law alumni were involved with this effort from the very beginning. It's hard for you to see, but at the very top left is Ferdinand Lee, Howard Law graduate. I'm going to come back to him. Below that, you see a name of Thomas L. Jones. He was an attorney, and he was a Howard University Law School graduate. He had a successful private practice doing criminal defense work, but also civil litigation in the local and federal courts. This was quite a feat because blacks weren't, you know, hired by the law firms, and a lot of the whites wouldn't hire black lawyers. and a lot of the black people didn't really have much money to pay lawyers, so it was very hard for someone to eke out a living in private practice, but he did so. Underneath there, you see advisory board. It's hard to see there on the upper left. And the first name under the advisory board is the Honorable Robert H. Terrell. Judge Terrell was a graduate of Howard University Law School. Some people call him the first black federal judge because he's the first black presidentially appointed judge. He didn't sit on the federal court. He sat on the local municipal court, but in those positions were appointed by the president. And he was a pillar of this community and involved in lots of efforts. Another name that's hard to see on the right-hand side near the bottom of that column is General J. Clay Smith, the father of a former professor here, J. Clay Smith. He was on the executive board of this organization. But I want to talk for a minute about Ferdinand Lee, because to me, he is the hero. He was the president and founder of the National Memorial Association. He went to Hampton University for college and Howard Law School. So I guess I can say he went to the real HU, and I'm not going to offend anyone because you won't know which one I'm talking about. But he was an organizational dynamo. He was involved in all sorts of activities to promote civil rights, to try to get black people jobs within the federal government, to help them pass the civil service exam, to honor black achievement. And he basically was the heart and soul of the National Memorial Association. So this is a flyer saying, lest we forget, talking about why they were doing what they were doing. The office is listed as 923 R Street Northwest, not far from the undergrad campus of Howard Law School, and that was Ferdinand Lee's house. Now, the movement started as a movement to create a memorial to soldiers and sailors. But there was very much a feeling that more was needed. At that time, the lynching of African Americans was probably, among the many, despicable things that were being done to the African American community, that was really at the top of the list. That was really one of the top reasons why the NAACP was formed, was to fight lynching. And it was such an inhumane practice. It wasn't just that blacks would be hung or executed outside of the legal system by a mob. It was the way that it was done. It was done openly in front of everyone. It wasn't hidden at all. It was done in a carnival-like atmosphere often, with fingers being chopped off and ears being cut off and given as souvenirs and people being burned alive. And so there was very much a sense that something needs to be done to try to make people understand that African Americans are human. I'm going to read to you something that was a petition that was sent to Congress on behalf of the National Equal Rights League, and composed of people who were part of the National Memorial Association, pleading for Congress to pass a federal anti-lynching law. And this is what they said. They said, the colored race is not available the necessary means to systematically and comprehensively gather and publish the facts concerning their achievements in the United States as a world group and place them before the American people. That each member of the race feels keenly the handicap suffered thereby and believes were a full, just, and widespread showing of these facts, narrating the part of the race that the race has borne towards building up America on land and sea, if that were placed before the world, it would serve effectually to greatly modify feeling against the colored race and be of inestimable help in it to battle for a man's chance in the struggle of existence. They were pleading to Congress to promote Negro achievement, maybe so that people will see us as people, as human beings, so that we would have a man's chance in the struggle for existence. They felt that they were under an existential threat, in that perhaps by promoting Negro achievement, people would see black people as humans and accordingly stop lynching them and stop discriminating against them and give them the full and equal rights that they were due under law. And so the scope of the project grew. It grew from just having some sort of memorial to Negro soldiers and sailors. It grew to the National Memorial Association saying, we should construct a memorial building that would have exhibits in it that would talk about the achievements of in inventions and business and education in all of these ways that we are contributing to the country and all of the things that we've done in this roughly half century since the end of slavery. And they had an African-American architect named Edward R. Williams construct a model that was 6 feet by 8 feet of a building. And that's a depiction of that model. They took a photograph of that model because the model was so big they couldn't carry it around everywhere, but they carried photographs around and they had those publicized in the newspapers and said, we want a building and it would look something like this. And it'll also have a big hall in it that can seat 4,000 to 5,000 people, because we want to be able to gather and do things, and there's no place where we can gather because they won't let us gather in any of the federal buildings or any of the big hotels. So we need our own gathering place. So it went from memorial to museum or memorial building. Now, when you think about this, it's really pretty audacious for them to ask for Congress to help them create something like this. At the same time, people in Congress are actively defending lynching and saying that they're, blacks hadn't really achieved anything, so why should we construct a building to support them? There's a Congressman Rankin from Mississippi who said during the debates on all of this, and I'm quoting, the people of the South have done more to take the Negro from his natural state of savagery in which they found him hundreds of years ago and lift him up and show him the ways of civilization than have any other people with whom he has come in contact in all of the ages past and gone. The white man in the South is the best friend the Negro ever had or ever will have again. A Congressman Busby from, I'm trying to remember, he was from Tennessee, I believe. He might have been from Alabama. argued that the Southern people are the friends of the Negro in the only proper way and in the only proper relation that can exist between white and black races. And they fiercely fought this legislation, didn't want the federal government to put a dime towards it, and didn't think that there was any need for it. Now, the National Memorial Association built this network of people in states all around the country in support of this. People like Mary McLeod Bethune, and Mary Church Terrell, Adam Clayton Powell, people from all over wrote in to ask Congress to support this, and some came to Washington when they finally got a hearing in 1928 to testify in favor of this. And somehow, some way, they were able to get the legislation passed in 1929. President Calvin Coolidge, on his very last day in office, one of his last official acts was to sign into law a bill that would create an entity called the National Memorial Commission to construct this memorial building. That commission had to raise at least $500,000, though, before they could get a penny from the federal government. And the timing was very bad, because in October of 1929, the stock market crashed and the Great Depression began. So try as they may have to work towards raising this money, they were not able to do so, and the effort just kind of died out. Ferdinand Lee passed away, the members of this commission passed away, the United States entered World War II. After World War II, civil rights movement started, and pretty much all of the efforts that they had done were forgotten. They were really out of the common public awareness. And when I started looking into this museum effort in the 1990s, I didn't know any of this that I'm just sharing with you. I looked around and I talked to people, and no one on the Hill seemed to know any of this, because we thought that really the effort to start an African-American museum started in the 1960s, especially after Dr. King's assassination. But there had been this movement much before. A bipartisan group came together to support this around the year 2000, when President George W. Bush took office and was able to get legislation passed to create a presidential commission, a new presidential commission, to write a plan to build a National Museum of African American History and Culture. I had the honor of serving on that commission. As you heard, I chaired its site and building committee. And one of life's many ironies, I went to work at a law firm, Venable LLP, at this time, and our firm moved from over on New York Avenue to where Venable is now, across from the Verizon Center in what was the Hex department store building. And the developers in Venable had decided to name the building Terrell Place in honor of Mary Church Terrell, because she had helped to lead the efforts to desegregate the lunch counter at Hex in that very building in the 1950s. Mary Church Terrell was also one of the members of that National Memorial Commission that was created in 1929. So as I moved into that building in 2002, I was in a building named after Mary Church Terrell, and I was serving on a presidential commission, and it was basically the same presidential commission that Mary Church Terrell had served on 75 years earlier. So I felt like I was literally standing on her shoulders as I was working on this commission to try to come up with a plan to get this museum built. We did come up with a plan. It was unanimously adopted by all the members of the commission, and it was turned into legislation that Congress passed in 2003. And this picture is of President Bush signing that bill into law. And I was fortunate to be able to be invited to the White House, and that's me standing behind President Bush as he's signing that bill into law to create the National Museum of African American History and Culture. It would take a couple more years of fighting and study for the site to be approved. The commission wanted the building to be sited on the mall. Congress could not agree to that. They couldn't agree whether it should be on the mall, and if so, where on the mall, so they punted that issue to the Smithsonian Board of Regents. In early 2006, the regents agreed with the commission's recommendation to place the museum on the mall. And so the next museum of the Smithsonian is going to be at this site that the director, Lonnie Bunch, and the deputy director, Kinshasha Holman Conwell, are pointing to. This is before construction, and they are on top of the Museum of American History, and they're pointing to the site across the street, across 14th Street, where the museum would be constructed. This is President Obama presiding over the groundbreaking ceremony for the museum. And here's a sketch of what the museum would look like. You can go see what it actually looks like, but this is a sketch. I'm pleased to say that we have two staff members, two curators from the museum here, Joanne Hippolyte and Michelle Wilkinson. Would you please stand? And, you know, the dream for me and so many people before me and so many other people who were working on this with me was to just be a catalyst to try to create the environment that this could happen so that people like Joanne and Michelle and Lonnie Bunch and Kinshasha could come along and execute it and create this beautiful, wonderful structure, this institution. And so when I see Joanne and Michelle, it's, to me, it's like they are the personification of my dreams. They are the dream come true because they are actually the people who are going to make this happen and bring it over the finish line. 100 years, practically to the day, after the National Memorial Association was first founded and the first legislation was introduced to create the museum. Now, as I close, I've told you about two marches, but I think I would be remiss if I didn't mention a third march down Pennsylvania Avenue, or a third parade down Pennsylvania Avenue. And these are depictions from President Obama's first inauguration in 2009. Walking down Pennsylvania Avenue, the very same avenue where the African American soldiers weren't invited to walk down in 1865 at the end of the Civil War. The same avenue where in 1915, 50 years too late, African American soldiers who were heroes finally got to walk down but were treated as second-class citizens. But now you have President Obama walking down and then saluting as Commander-in-Chief of the United States Armed Forces. What do you think any of those veterans would have said to you in 1865 if you had told them that you had come from a time machine and you were coming back to tell them that there would be an African-American Commander-in-Chief who would walk down Pennsylvania Avenue, the same avenue that they weren't allowed to walk down to get any kind of glory or recognition for the part that they had played to preserve the Union? I think that they would tell you that you were crazy, not just because you would be telling them you were coming from a time machine. But that, I think, exemplifies to me how far we've come as a nation. And yet, we haven't come as far, perhaps, as some of us would like, and we haven't cured the evils of racial discrimination and inequality and bigotry, but we have come a long way. And I think that this museum, in a lot of ways, personifies that journey. And I look forward to an opening. And I'm writing a book about that journey. And I look forward to sharing that book with you when it's finished, concurrent with the opening of the museum. Thank you very much.
Thank Judge Wilkins again for his wonderful remarks and for giving us that tremendously moving history of the National Museum of African American History and Culture. I am so excited about the opening of this museum. Just getting to drive by it is an inspiration, and so for all of us to be able to witness this, I think is just a tremendous honor. So thank you to Judge Wilkins. If you notice what the theme of the day is, it's civic engagement, and it's lawyers as leaders, right? So we hope that when you graduate from this law school, that you will exhibit the leadership that we see from Ferdinand Lee, that we see from Judge Wilkins, that we see from many lawyers who go out and not just represent their clients, not just work in their law firms and work for the government and nonprofits, but really go out and change their communities for the better, change their nations for the better, change the world. And that's what we aspire to for all of you, and we'll continue that discussion later tonight. But first, we want to present Judge Wilkins with a small gift and token of our appreciation. Very good. We also want to welcome Judge Wilkins' law clerks who are here with us today, if they will stand up. If any of you have questions about clerking, and I have to point out that one of his clerks is Ryan Grover, who I taught in federal courts only a few years ago, so many of you can be right there. Not too long ago, we hope that you'll meet some future law clerks here today. And so thank you so much for being here, and we will reconvene tonight at 6 p.m. to welcome Donna Brazile to talk about election 2016 and the need to mobilize and protect the vote. So I look forward to seeing all of you then. Thank you.